what exactly is evolution? In biology, the theory of evolution doesn't tell us exactly how life began on Earth, but it helps us understand how life, once it came into existence, diversified into the many incredible forms we see now. In biology, evolution is the change of the characteristic of a species over several generations and relies on the process of natural selection. Evolution may be defined as any net directional change or any cumulative change in characteristics of organisms or populations over many generations. In other words, descent with modifications. Its explicitly includes the origin as well as the spread of alleles, variants, trait values, or character states.
So, I will now talk about the history of evolution and the proponents involved in its emergence and development. Like everything in this world, living or non-living, must have an origin, and evolution is not an exception. The concept of evolution was already present and was talked about by ancient Greek philosophers such as Anaximander, which stated that animals can transform from one kind to another, and Empedocles, who believed that existing parts can be combined to create another being. The advancement of evolution was not always free, for the massive influence of the church restricted them to further advance and believe in the creation from the book of Genesis. So the first proponent of the history of evolution was Pierre-Louis Moreau de Maupertuis, who proposed the concept of spontaneous generation. Georges Louis Leclerc is a naturalist that rejected the concept of different species having a common ancestry. Carlos Linnaeus, or the father of taxonomy, who created the hierarchical system, which paved way to prove the mutation of species. The grandfather of Charles Darwin, Erasmus Darwin, has given insights in evolution written in his book entitled Zoonomia. Jean-Baptiste Lamarck has proposed the evolutionary theory of the inheritance of acquired characteristics, which will be discussed further into this presentation. The father of the theory of evolution, the proponent of natural selection, is Charles Darwin. So he has written all about his theory on the Book of Origin of the Species in 1859. Take note that this version of the book is only the first. So at the same time, naturalist Alfred Wallace has come up with an almost similar theory as Darwin's natural selection. The only difference is that Wallace believes that divine intervention was present. The philosopher Herbert Spencer has come up with the slogan, "Survival of the Fittest," which will be later added to Darwin's more updated editions of the book Origin of Species. But Spencer's understanding of natural selection was deemed generalized as to why Darwin has often attacked him for it. So next is Gregor Mendel, or the father of modern genetics, who provided the world with Mendelian genetics and the theory of heredity. August Weismann, a German biologist, has published a theory defending the theory of natural selection. This later became the Neo-Darwinism theory. So under this theory are the rediscovery of natural selection and the Mendelian genetics. Hugo de Vries has proposed a theory of mutationism, which was quickly opposed by biometrics such as Carl Pearson. So Theodosius Dobzhansky has a published book called Genetics and the Origin of Species. So this book contains the combination of Mendelian genetics and natural selection. So, these are only some of the people who played a huge role in discovering evolution. It's only thanks to them that we know so much about the origin and evolution of life.
We are going to talk about the myths of evolution. So, myth number one, humans evolved from monkeys, which is obviously not true. Humans never evolved from monkeys. We never once were monkeys. We do share a common ancestor with monkeys, and that we are kind of maybe cousins with monkeys. We are related to them, but we never came from them. Myth number two. Evolution is just a theory. Let's first clear up that the word theory in scientific community weighs so much more Usually, common people think that theory and hypothesis are the same thing, which is not true. A hypothesis is any idea that you think is testable. A theory is some idea that is organized and now has evidences that it can be true. So yes, evolution is just a theory in a community of scientific people, or the science community. Therefore, evolution has its evidences that it happened. Number three, if nobody saw it, it can't be sure that it happened. So obviously that's a myth. Just because we were not able to live long enough or exist long enough to see the evolution can be proved by single fossils that were collected and now can be observed through time that there were some changes. However, if you want to see a real-time evolution, you should see the microevolution or the microorganism evolution. Specifically, the influenza virus that changes or evolves every year. It has its own characteristics every year. And it cannot be stopped by the same vaccine from last year. That's why you need to take your flu shots every year. Therefore, evolution can be observed in microorganism. Therefore, science can say anything about the origin. Well, although the origin is a story of history, science can say something about the origin. Why? Because once origin happens, historical evidences is preserved in physical record. Therefore, we were able to observe what was alive or what was the origin of the earth by the evidences it left on us. And we were able to observe and study them through methodology that we use in science. Although science can't simulate what was the origin, science can honestly say something about the origin of life and earth. Evolution means humans are just animals. That is true. According to natural selections, humans are parts of the animal kingdom. However, we are the highest form of animals that are capable of rational thinking. Because we were able to use our minds as a protection for ourselves, as other animals use claws and fangs to protect themselves, even their skin can be used to protect themselves. Humans use their mind to protect themselves from everything else in the environment. We were able to make tools, we were able to make shelters, and we were able to make materials that serves us for food source, and we were able to cultivate our own food source. There is no intermediate fossil. That is not true. Fossil record shows that there are gradual accumulation of change, but it was in a long period of time. You see, there were a category of changes that happened between a fish and an amphibian where the fins were used for swimming once, and now, as the transition goes by, it became some kind of a limb they use on land. Therefore, the amphibians. Evolution is not testable. First of all, not all science investigation involve a direct experiment. We don't need to simulate the evolution or anything to prove that it really did happen, to prove on science name that something really did happen. We were able to do this observation through fossils that we have collected through time. The older fossils look different than the next millennia of fossils. And from there, we can say that evolution did happen. However, there is a little exception to this. Evolution can be observed through a microlens, where microorganisms have distincted themselves from one species to another. Let's say the influenza virus. There are so many types of influenza virus. Why? Because they specify themselves to adapt in their environment. So what was the influenza last year may not be the same influenza that is existing now. And that is why we take a different flu shot every year. That is the microevolution that happened in the influenza virus. 8. Evolution is just random. There is a truth in this. Randomness does not mean meaningless, however. It is something that cannot be predicted. So, let's say a human being from a parent, they both have to share genes for their offspring. We cannot tell what the offspring will look like or be like in the future. However, there is a certainty in a part of it where cytosine and thymine and guanine and adenine will be together. Just because of its randomness doesn't mean it didn't help on the survival of the species. It may be something they would have shared to their child that will make them more adapted to the environment they're in. Arise naturally. There is a trait in this, but traits don't need to be functional for some ultimate product to be selected for as long as it provides useful functions to all, natural selection will select it to survive and reproduce. And on this trait, sometimes they come along with other traits that is not useful for them. Let's say on the depths of the sea, some fishes there have eyes. Although they did not use it because there is no light in that space, they still have eyes. And as humans, we use our eyes to see the environment around us. You see, we have the same traits but different functions, but they just came along with different traits that helped us to navigate the world. They cannot arise naturally. Number 10. Evolution can't account for morality. Evolution is a religion. So let's talk about the first sentence. Evolution can't account for morality. That is true, because evolution talks about animals and other organisms that is for their natural state. They do not have rationality. And morality are for those who have rational thinking, like humans. Therefore, we cannot account irrational animals to human morality. And move on to the evolution is a religion. No, evolution is not a religion. Evolution is a scientific fact which is supported by insurmountable of evidences. We cannot deny evolution happened in us or in the world. Completely based on evidences and facts, it is not something we can just turn our eyes around or not see. It is something that happened. But it doesn't mean it's a religion just because a lot of people believes in it. People don't put their faith on the evolution, except for the cult, but that's a different story.
Jean-Baptiste Pierre-Antoine de Monet, Chevalier de Lamarck, was a French naturalist, biologist, academic, and soldier. He was an early proponent of the idea that biological evolution occurred and proceeded in accordance with natural laws. Lamarck is best known for his theory of inheritance of acquired characters, which states that if an organism changes throughout its lifespan in order to adapt to its environment, those changes are passed on to its children. Lamarck theory. What is it? Jean-Baptiste de Monet Lamarck proposed Lamarckism between the years of 1744 and 1829. Based on the idea that all physical changes and individual experiences during their lifetime are passed down to their descendants, this theory was developed. As an illustration, repeated use can cause an organ to develop. In order to live when conditions changed, creatures had to adapt their behavior. An organ's lifespan would lengthen if they started using it more frequently than before, for instance. For
instance, if a giraffe stretched its neck to reach for leaves, nervous fluid would flow into its neck, lengthening it. The larger neck would be passed down to its progeny, and further straining would lengthen it, still across many generations. Organs that organisms stopped using would shrink at this time. Organisms are propelled toward increasing complexity. This type of evolution, for which Lamarck is best known today, was just one of two theories he put out. Nature also moved creatures inexorably upward from primitive forms to increasingly sophisticated ones as they adapted to their environments.
There is four major theory of evolution. The first is Lamarckism, also known as the theory of inheritance of acquired characteristics, proposed by a French naturalist Jean-Baptiste Lamarck in 1809. In this theory, an organism can acquire characteristics based on their parents' lifestyle. Animal example of this is the giraffe. A giraffe have high food source, or the trees. They stretch their neck as far as they can, and so the offspring will have longer neck than their parents. A human example of this is if a man that has a lot of physical work, let's say metal workers or swordsmiths or blade makers, they use their upper arm muscle a lot in their work. So in this theory, their children will have stronger upper arm muscle than their parents when they are born. However, this theory is disapproved by the scientific community. Although the theory of Lamarckism is disapproved, it is the foundation of some other evolution theories that will arise later on. So let's make more emphasis of the importance of this theory. So it has the hypothesis of change to use and disuse, where what we don't use anymore will be gone in the ends of the generation. However, the things we use will be developed by the next generation. If we are more intellectual now, the next generation will be much more complex, which is the next one I will talk about, where organisms is driven into greater complexity. We were once simple, and then we became complex through time, which is the foundation of the next theories that will come. Although Lamarckian's inheritance theory is a bit lackful, and it is not being able to be observed in nature, and it cannot be proved, it is the idea today known mainly in textbook, where we use historical contrast for our modern understanding of genetics.
Charles Darwin, a naturalist, studied the concept of natural selection in the 19th century. Natural selection shows how a species' genetic characteristics might alter over time. The emergence of a distinctive new species, known as speciation, may result from this. Since Darwin's first book on natural selection was published in 1859, and it's a groundbreaking book on the origin of species, presented his theories on natural selection and evolution. These theories were mostly based on observations that Darwin made while traveling the world. What is the evolution theory put out by Charles Darwin? Darwin and Alfred Russel Wallace, one of his scientific contemporaries, proposed that natural selection, or evolution, is the result of this process. According to the principle of natural selection, organisms breed more young than they can withstand in their surroundings. Three principles underlie Darwin's theory of natural selection. Most traits are inherited. There are more offspring produced.
Produce more offspring than the individuals with the less advantageous traits. These three principles result in natural selection, which is an unavoidable process. Darwin's theory consisted of two main points. 1. Diverse groups of animals evolve from one or a few common ancestors. 2. The mechanism by which this evolution takes place is natural selection. And according to Charles Darwin, Variation, Volume 2, hypotheses may often be of service to science when they involve a certain portion of incompleteness and even of error. Under this point of view, I venture to advance the hypothesis of pangenesis. The ability for naturally existing changes to be inherited was essential to Darwin's theories of species evolution. Although it was evident that inheritance functioned at the time he wrote Origin, he didn't have an explanation for how it did.
In his book Variation of Animals and Plants Under Domestication, published in 1868, Darwin made an attempt to explain how heredity might operate. This description, known as his provisional hypothesis of pangenesis, was later revised for a second printing in 1875. The whole idea of inheritance, according to Darwin, is fascinating. When a new character emerges, regardless of its nature, it usually has a tendency to be inherited, at the very least temporarily and occasionally in a very persistent way. The real surprise is about pangenesis was an attempt to show the means by which characters of all types are passed from generation to generation, not that a character should be inherited, but that any should ever fail to be inherited.
The next theory is theory of natural selection, proposed by English naturalist Charles Darwin. After his five-year voyage to study plants, animals, and fossils in the South America and islands of the Pacific in 1859, found in his best-selling book On the Origin of the Species. In this theory, natural selection is a process through which population of a living organism adapt and change. And in that population, there are naturally variables. Variables meaning they are all different in some ways, or they have certain characteristics that are different in each one. In each variable, let's call them traits. Traits are better suited for a certain environment than the other. Therefore, the adaptive trait will be advantageous and they are more likely to survive and reproduce. And over time, because this is more suited to the environment, that trait will be common in the population. Natural selection can also lead to specification, where species give rise to new, distinct, different species. The example of this is the felines or the cats. There are domesticated cats, there are small wild cats, and there are big cats. So each one of them have different environment on the others. These are the specification of the feline genus. Basic tenets of evolution and the natural selection defined by Darwin. 1. More individuals are produced each generation that can survive, meaning a species that can reproduce faster than the other is more likely to survive in the next millennia. And 2, phenetic variation exists among individuals and variation is heritable. This is the reason why it can survive. Each one of that species or offspring can have a variation or trait that is unique to them, and that trait can be passed to the next generation, or the word heritable. 3. Those individuals with heritable traits better suited for the environment will survive. And if the trait or variation is more suited for the environment, then obviously that organism will survive and make more organism like itself, which comes to the fore. When reproductive isolation occurs, new species will form. Meaning when the trait that is heritable and adaptive and advantageous is common in the population, then new species. Darwin is not the only one that end up in this conclusion, but also Alfred Wallace. They wrote a book together, and then they disagreed on one thing, which is a divine intervention, which Wallace believes in, and Darwin don't. And so Darwin made his own book by himself, and it was widely accepted by the science community. However, there are holes in the natural selection theory, which will be the next theory.
The mutation theory of evolution, or mutationism. This theory was proposed by Hugo de Vries, a Dutch botanist, in the 1901. And according to mutationism, evolution is a discontinuous and jerky process. Compared sa theories ni Darwin and Lamarck, ito yung kabaliktaran. Kasi according to Darwin and Lamarck, evolution daw is a continuous and gradual process. Whatever changes that take place in an organism are due to sudden changes in the genetic makeup of the organism. So to support his claims, nag-conduct ng experiment si Hugo de Vries sa evening primrose, which is a plant. He selected some plants, and after self-pollination, he found out majority ng plants ay nagpakita ng minor variations and very few lang yung nagpakita ng major variations. Habang pinaperform yung experiments niya, napansin niyang merong sudden changes between generations. For example, napansin niyang yung offspring ay kamukha ng parent pero merong iilang different, kung saan meron silang difference with the shape ng kanilang leaves or sa sizes ng plants. And yung changes na yon ay tinawag niyang mutations. And by the way, individuals with mutations are referred to as mutants. It is important to study mutationism or mutations because isa sa major concept nito, yung genetic variation, ay nagbibigay ng valuable information about evolutionary change. Subsequent changes are dependent on variations, and mutation is responsible for all genetic variations. According to de Vries, who was joined by other geneticists such as William Bateson in England, meron daw dalawang kinds ng variation na nagtitake place sa organisms. Una is yung ordinary variation, which can be observed in individuals in a species, kung saan walang permanent impact sa evolution since, sabi nga rin ni de Vries, it cannot lead to a transgression of the species boundary or the creation of new species, even under conditions of the most rigorous and sustained selection. And yung pangalawa naman involves genetic changes caused by mutation, kung saan nag-result naman ito sa significant changes sa organism and ipag-usbong ng bagong species. According to this, the new species thus originates suddenly. So, it was produced from the pre-existing species and it emerged without any observable preparation and transition. Maraming naturalist ang kumontra sa idea ng mutationism, especially yung mga biometricians na pinangunahan ni Carl Pearson, an English statistician, kung saan dinedefend kasi nila na yung natural selection daw ni Charles Darwin ang primary driver ng evolution. Pinaniwalaan din nila na evolution can be passed from one generation to the next nang hindi nalilimitahan ng Mendel's laws of inheritance. So throughout the 1920s and the 1930s, gumawa ng theoretical work yung geneticist kung saan nakapag-contribute din yon sa eventual settlement ng debate between biometricians and mutationists. Ginamit ng mga scientists na to yung mathematical arguments para mag-demonstrate ng two points. Una is yung Mendel's laws could be the reason kung bakit merong continuous variation sa traits ng organism kagaya ng body size and egg production. And pangalawa, natural selection acting cumulatively on small variations could result in significant evolutionary changes in form and function of the organisms.
The third theory is the theory of mutationism, proposed by the Dutch botanist Hugo de Vries. In this theory, it gives to the hypothesis that there are new species that originate suddenly or spontaneously without any transition from its parents. So the organism had its own characteristic that is not found in both parents. In line with this is a geneticist such as William Bateson in England. There are two variability in this theory. That is, one, the ordinary variability, which is found among all individual species. And then the second one is the one we call the mutationism, which is something new or something unique to that certain organism. It is a sudden change of characteristic without even transitions. But then again, back then, Mendel's theory wasn't even yet discovered. So that we will tackle later on the last theory of evolution.
Neo-Darwinian theory or the modern synthetic theory. This theory is simple yet quite complex kasi ito ay collective study or synthesis ng iba't ibang studies na ginawa ng iba't ibang scientist kung saan na-discover nila yung general knowledge about evolution itself and yung iba't ibang fields ng sciences na inaaral natin today. Sinasabi nito na natural selection is copying random changes in the genetic code thought to be a source of a new form in the history of life. And according to the modern synthesis theory of evolution, ang populations ay nakapag-experience ng genetic alterations which result in the emergence of new species. And furthermore, nagbibigay ito ng clarification sa genetic population, gene pool, and gene regularity. Yung concept ng synthetic theory of evolution ay didiscuss din yung recombination or variation, mutation heredity, natural selection, and isolation. So basically, modern synthesis theory uses Mendelian inheritance or specifically Mendel's rules to explain how the natural selection of Charles Darwin works in real time. In terms of how evolution and the evolutionary process are conceptualized, the modern synthetic theory of evolution demonstrated a number of modifications. Sinasabi ng idea nito na merong bagong definition ng evolution, which is changes happening in allele frequencies within population, kung saan binigyang emphasis nito yung genetics of evolution. Genetic research has been used to support the current synthetic idea. Natalakay nito yung iba't ibang concepts na nagbabago kapag nagkakaroon ng changes sa allele frequency ng isang population. Yung pag-develop naman ng bagong species ay nangyayari lamang kapag merong enough significant alterations. And also, dinefine nito ang species to be as a group of individuals that have the ability to breed with each other and produce a fertile offspring.
And the last theory is the Neo-Darwinian theory or the modern synthetic theory. And August Weismann, who published his germplasm theory, which is the combination of the natural selection and Mendelian's theory. In this theory, it describes the evolution of life in terms of genetic changes occurring in a population that leads to the formation of new species, where Mendelian population and gene pool and gene frequency was discussed by some geneticists, R.A. Fisher, Sewell Wright, and J.B.S. Haldane, in which all information was compiled by Theodosius Dobzhansky, and he published a book that is now widely accepted by the community of science. And up to this point, we still believe that the Darwinian theory is the more reliable theory of all that have been discussed.
What are the evidence do we have to support common ancestry and biological evolution over time? Well, there are multiple lines of evidence to support evolution. Let's just look for a few. These are the homologous features, molecular biology, biogeography, fossil record, and direct observation of microevolution. So, what is homologous feature? Homologous feature are body parts of different organisms that are similar in structure but different in function. If you look at the picture here, you see the human arm, the dog leg, the bird wing, and the whale flipper. They all have similar structure but they have different functions. Molecular biology is one of the ways we can highlight the evolutionary process. It shows that all living things share the same genetic material called DNA, the same or very similar genetic code, and the same process gene expression known as transcription and translation. This feature suggests that all living things on Earth are distinctly related and share a common ancestry that had DNA that has its genetic material. Biogeography. Biogeography is the study of geographic distribution of plants and animals. It tells us how the habitat of a certain species contribute to its change of characteristics for its to evolve and survive. Biogeography affects the variation of species in a way that different species to try and survive in different areas. Fossils provide evidence of long-term evolutionary changes, documenting the past existence of species that are now extinct. Fossil record. The fossil record is our greatest source of evidence for evolution because it tells us that species from the past were very different than they are today. While the fossil record is incomplete and we only have fossils for a fraction of species that have existed, we have evidence of change over time. Fossils cannot provide DNA, so scientists analyze the structural evidence to look for similarities and differences and use chemical evidence to determine the age of the fossils. And lastly, is the direct observation of microevolution. In some cases, the evidence of evolution is that we can see it taking place around us. Important modern-day examples of evolution include the emergence of drug-resistant bacteria and pesticide-resistant insects. Example, in 1950s, there was a worldwide effort to eradicate malaria by eliminating its carriers. The pesticide DDT was sprayed broadly in areas where the mosquitoes lived, and at first, the DDT was highly effective in killing the mosquitoes. However, over time, the DDT became less and less effective, and more mosquitoes survived. This was because the mosquito population evolved resistance to the pesticides.
Greetings. We have now reached the end point of our report, so now you will have a taste of the greatest conclusion you will ever have. To search for our origin had been one of the greatest goals of mankind, whether it would be divine intervention or spontaneous generation, and how us modern humans, animals, and plants came to be is what evolution tackles. The oldest civilization couldn't have spontaneously appeared. There had to be a transition. There are heaps of evidences that prove evolution right, and even the Roman Catholic Church had long accepted it. It always comes to a point of heavy debate for proving a theory right or wrong. We are fortunate to have great minds that fight through criticism to prove a valid point. To put it crudely, survival of the fittest, as Herbert Spencer said. Our strongest weapon is our brains. Let's keep that by staying curious. The gate is always open.